Meeting of the planning zoning commission, the call for will come to order. First, we need to appoint both alternates as voting members. Michael Flint and Kathy Sharon. First item on the agenda is approval of the agenda. Are there any additions to the agenda?
I'd like to make a motion to approve as written.
Just could I clarify before we go ahead and finish? Where I said Kathy, I need your help. Kathy's helped me, and I've added the actual attachment that was written into the record to the minutes, so.
Oh, great.
It'll say, instead of Kathy, I need your help, it'll say, see attachment.
We're on the agenda.
Oh, I'm sorry. I don't have to step on it. Forget it.
Catch up with you.
Forget it. I don't need to say it now.
Right. I would suggest that we move items six and seven, the whole business, to the end so that these good folks don't have to wait through all that, all the talk about the regulations before we get to them. Go home and enjoy the evening.
We can?
And.
Oh.
No.
We're at the beginning of the meeting.
I got it.
Right, right. Yeah, we've got to stay forward, but they don't. So, do we have a motion to approve the agenda as amended?
So move.
Second.
Second. Kathy? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Next is the minutes of May 21st.
Now.
Now, yeah.
Now. I'll remember what I said.
Right. Marty?
No comment.
No?
John? Just a couple of minor ones. I was making a comment, but page one, line five, I think, just have to insert the word by after 6:30.
Right.
And on page two, line three, I know it's repetitive, but we really do need to say where it's going to be held in the town hall, line three. Sorry.
At the end of line three?
Yeah.
We can say the upstairs conference room.
Yeah, whatever that normal language is, I know it's repetitive, but it's important to begin with.
Right.
Especially when it's a public hearing.
There you go.
And then on line six, after David Cusick changed was to were. That's all I had.
Okay. Mike?
Yeah.
Kathy?
This first page, line seven, motion was made by Sig Shah, seconded by.
Yeah, right.
And also, after 9:29, didn't we read into the record from Thomas McDermott earlier when we were discussing this?
We read it during correspondence, didn't we?
I don't think so. I think we read it earlier, and we discussed it, and we discussed it at quite some length, and I think we should have at least a line or two that reflected the comments that were made by the commissioners, which was that plenty of time had been given, plenty of notice and plenty of time had been given to the property owners. And secondly, there was a discussion that one of the comments in Thomas McDermott's letter referred to manufacture of small parts or something, assembly of small parts. And I think it was discussed and agreed that that would be considered grandfathering or whatever to the business, and that it wouldn't matter, that it was no longer available for the change of zone.
Yeah, very legally non-conforming.
Right.
Under the current change in the zone.
Thank you. So that's why I think we've discussed that measure earlier. We read that measure from earlier. And we had significant discussion. I think we should have a line that refers to that.
Okay. Do you have any particular?
Yeah, we do.
Do you have any particular liners?
Suggest? After 9:29, it could be at this stage Thomas McDermott's letter was read into the record and discussed.
Where do we have that list?
Perhaps the commission has acknowledged that, and you need the wording from this letter actually, the activity would be considered, what did we just say? We had two points in there, one is about the city.
So we had parks and products, or is it research lab?
Okay, so going back to what we wanted at this stage, Thomas McDermott's letter was read into the record and discussed. The commissioners believe that, and quote, the manufacture and assembly of parts for products would be able to continue in that building because it would be
as a wing, not a permanent use.
Right.
Okay. Great.
And nothing else.
Okay. See, on line 29, I would take out district. It's a zone. We had kind of decided that districts were only for overlays. Line 32, remove clarification. And that's it.
Okay.
We have a motion to approve the minutes as amended.
So moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Next up is public comment. Any public comment?
Sometime this summer, I was going to come before the commission to help you all clarify the definition of impervious surface. And I was thinking about a format. All the calculations that I've done in the past since the regulation on each project, they seemed, the definition seems to change. And so I was just going to bring forward all those stone steps, wood decks, and all that stuff. And
terraces
and dry stone walls and stone walls with concrete. Flagstone steps that are 3 foot by 4 foot, or even natural stone steps that are 3 foot by 4 foot. How do you handle the different sizes? And you know, if there's no kind of detail.
Mm-hmm.
Is that okay? Coming forward that way.
Great. Something we've kind of, you know, put off for a while.
Okay. I'll make an appointment.
Great.
Okay.
Good. Okay. That's it for public comment. Selectman status update on former local fires. Kurt?
I would hand you out a little document. We as a board haven't met to discuss this, but we do have a meeting on Thursday, so thought that maybe it would be a good idea to get your all input. And we didn't post this as a selectman's meeting, but but we're all here in case there are comments, because we have a meeting. Jim handed me one recently, just tonight, that has some comma changes, but
just minor typos.
Minor, but we have two parties who have been to you who are interested in making an offer on the former firehouse. So the question is, how do we proceed? And this document was page 1 of 3 from 2 years ago that was written by the town attorney. But at that point, we were going to have a little auction type of a situation where bids were going to get received by the selectmen at a certain time, and to be a, quote, qualified bidder, you had to meet these A through I. And then the selectmen were going to decide, well, then there was going to be a little, they were going to make an offer, and then half an hour later or something, have a chance to up their offer based on what other people were doing. And then at that point, it was up to the selectmen to decide whether these were good offers, worth taking to a town meeting. When we got to that point, we only had one bid, so the whole auction thing was done. And I personally would not like to repeat that, because I think we have two people who have expressed interest who have gone beyond what we did last time, which is come to P&Z and be given sort of a green light. Mm-hmm. So I don't see what our role is in this other than to receive the offers and try to consummate it if the town meeting approves one of them, or there may be a third or fourth or fifth. So we need to talk about all that a little bit tonight, if we could, in advance of our selectmen's meeting when we're all speaking about that. And please, the other selectmen, please share with this conversation. So I just took what we did before and inked out some of the there was talking in B about at least 10%. Some of these things I think probably should be met before they go to a town meeting. And the really substantive one also I inked out at the bottom, but the town attorney suggested later today, when he got back to us, that we might want to reconsider inking out. The selectmen may want to reject offers rather than just send everything to a town meeting. For example, if somebody bids $50,000 and they only have $5,000, I don't think we need to send that to a town meeting. But that's, we will talk about that as our board, but we wanted to not bypass you, seeing as how we're both meeting the same meeting. I don't know what your thoughts are.
Right, so these are two of the ones that we discussed in general terms a while back.
Yeah.
As you know, we've changed the zone from R20 to CG20, so there are a lot more uses that are available to anyone who purchased the firehouse. As long as, of course, it's obvious that they would have to come before us with a site plan application, and when it finally came down to nuts and bolts, if someone was to purchase the property and just stay in the obvious, but
so would they be likely to, should they come for a site plan application before we go to a town meeting? What if they went to a town meeting, they were approved at the town meeting, and then their site plan wasn't approved, or they didn't have enough parking, or whatever, I don't know. That gets you to letter I on this, which is if somebody makes an offer and then doesn't follow through with it, does the second bidder get to keep, does the bidder stay in for a while in case that first one, I don't know. I can't answer all this, and I don't know if our board can. It's really a town.
Well, right. John?
Well, I think at this stage, the commission's role is somewhat limited, even though it's important, because I think after, my understanding anyway, is we don't have anything to do with this process. All we have to decide on is whether it meets the town plan of conservation and development after you get the offer, not before.
And if anybody makes an offer, I would suggest, at least from my point of view, that they make a conditional on approval from P&amp;Z, because we can't pre-approve something that people don't know.
But you would do it before town meeting?
No, after. They would have to have the town meeting so that they would be a qualified buyer. This is just my opinion. But then, whatever the business application would be, the site plan would come to the commission for review, understanding all of that, but we couldn't pre-approve it. I mean, we've given some pretty conditional approvals to the type of business, and so without specifics.
We have had people come forward with a concept for a site plan to get an indication, right, of whether...
Right, I'm just distinguishing between approved site plan and...
Right, but I don't think that anybody that's going to offer the sort of money that's required for the firehouse will also be talking to architects or engineers or builders about what they need to do to adapt the building. And therefore they would have, because of the costs involved, and they would have some idea of what alterations they're going to require. And maybe there could be an informal review, as we've done for other people in the building.
Yeah, I'm just distinguishing between an informal review and a qualified site plan.
So at least that could happen prior to a public meeting.
Well, what we've done so far earlier was to discuss the use. If the use was appropriate, it wasn't really a preliminary site plan. Review. It was only the question of whether it's an appropriate use.
So anybody that's going to buy that building is probably going to do some work on it for one of the uses that they've talked to us about. In doing that, they are going to be looking at what the town's regulations will allow.
I would think that a buyer would, or their attorney would say, we'll only buy this
contingent
on town meeting approval and P&Z approval.
Well, that's what happened with the first one.
That's what's been happening. And maybe we should add something in here that the uses are consistent with all state and local and federal regulations. I don't know. Do you think we should screen out a little bit? Or maybe we'll talk about this as a course.
Yes, because you're not going to accept an offer of $50,000, are you?
Well, I don't know. I mean, we're not accepting. The question is, what our role is, to accept the offers or to just transfer them all over to a town meeting. And that's not your problem. It's our problem.
That's not.
That was one question.
Right. That's fine. We'll figure that one out. But
I guess what we're saying is that there would be an opportunity for a preliminary site review, because we've done that for other people on much smaller projects.
Right. No, but that's for property owners, though. This is when someone can really do something. We're talking about giving a preliminary review to someone who wants to buy a piece, and that's a very dangerous precedent to set.
Okay.
Because the next guy that comes to town wants to buy a piece of property, well, he wants us to do a pre-review before he buys it. I thoroughly object to doing any pre-review. The selectmen have to decide what's going to that town meeting for a sale. And it's after that, people need to do their due diligence on the zoning, what they can and cannot do, and have a firm grip. And it's after that that we then approve or don't approve a site plan.
Yeah.
And it's, have you done it for non-property owners?
We shouldn't. The only other thing that I wanted to mention, I think we should offer other people a chance to make an offer. So we were talking about, and I just penciled this in, again, this is very much a draft, but 2 o'clock on July 5th, which is a Friday, which is a month after our selectmen's meeting, to say that not only these two people, but advertise it to anybody else, on that day, you should satisfy at least whatever we decide, A through I, you know, you have to have a deposit. You have to be qualified to buy this property. I do think that the town meeting would ask that they tell us what the use is for it, but maybe I'm wrong on that, I don't know. You know, we early on decided not to just auction it off for anybody to pay top dollar. We could have done that, we could have an auction on July 5th.
Well, any offer has to, by statute, has to come before us for a report, right? Not necessarily an up and down vote.
Yeah.
And the vote isn't, you know, binding at all. Because at least the way I've read it is that if you have a town meeting form of government, of municipal government, then you only need a majority vote to overrule the PNC.
Right.
Right.
And if
so, you have to provide an explanation for your decision, as I
right, right. Yeah, if we were to.
Or we don't have to provide any kind of a decision at all.
Right, and if we're not heard from in 30 days, then the point is moot.
But they are required to
bring it. But they're required to present to us for a report.
Okay. Once again, that's before the town meeting.
Right.
Because that gets reported right to the town meeting.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Your vote, if that.
Right.
We're supposed to have a month
for
the town meeting to review.
I don't know if we put that in this. We probably should. That it's conditional on P&Z. It's not conditional on your approval, it's conditional on your consideration.
Consideration, right.
It's not conditional at all. Mm-hmm. We have to consider it within the 30-day period. It's not conditional on anything we say.
Well, I don't know if we should make that.
It needs to be presented for...
How we present that?
It needs to be presented to us.
It's a requirement for the town process. It has nothing to do with the buyer.
Right.
Right, right.
Yeah, they don't have to come to the formal to us.
Purchaser of town assets.
Mm-hmm.
That just comes to the planning.
Yeah.
Mike, could you repeat that? I thought you did have to have the opportunity to express an opinion, which means they would come, or you're saying you know enough now?
No, they don't need to come. We just simply review whatever the proposal is, and we either render an opinion or we don't.
Right. And if we don't act on it within 30 days, I think it's 30 days, right?
Yeah.
Then you can go ahead anyway.
So we would be silent on that meeting. Should we just say, I mean,
well, it doesn't really, this isn't an advisory opinion or anything. The town meeting can do whatever it wants, regardless of what this board says. So I don't really see it as a big issue. They submit their bid, you take the bid, right, send it to town meeting, and they know that inevitably they have to face us in the real world, which is when they go to actually do something. Mm-hmm. We can't impact that sale at all.
Well, only that the public would hopefully take our advice, and you know that has an effect on their voting on it.
But do we even ask them to seek your advice before we go to the town meeting? I think that's, we have to be careful.
I think you just have to present it to us, is the way I understand it.
Yeah,
it's and really then for a report. And
yeah, it's not really accurate to say your advice doesn't have any impact on the sale, because last time that's what Query said.
Yeah, that's
what
they looked at as their contract.
They had it in their
contract. That's only because they had
it
in
their choice.
I'm sure they'll have it again if they have an intelligent lawyer, which I'm sure they will.
So maybe that's just up to them and it's their condition.
That's a whole different issue. I mean, there shouldn't have been a decision by this commission on what the use was. It should have been related to whether we met the Salisbury, town of Salisbury plan for mm-hmm. development. That's all we're required to do, and the commission did.
Oh, that's okay then. I mean, that'll make our lives a little bit easier. Mm-hmm. If that's
policy, read the state statute, that's all our role is.
Mm-hmm. Listen, maybe there's
nothing to do with
in your contract or whatever, you should say with state statute where just the number that deals with having to come before the zoning commission.
I mean,
and they can determine
if
they're
and we've just right. revised the town plan, so if it meets mm-hmm. the conditions in there, we don't really have any authority to say anything different other than our personal opinion.
Right. Mark, do you have anything?
No.
Jim?
Thank you.
Okay, well, that's all. I just wanted to bring this up for you before we talk about it on Thursday.
Very good.
Much appreciated. If you have any other thoughts, let us know, because we would maybe post this thing, or at least the press will be there Thursday. You know, the two people who are interested have already contacted us, our office, saying we're getting ready to make an offer. So that's when we said, I think we're going to say we don't want one offer before the other. We want them both sealed up
right.
Same time and get other people a chance to also make an offer. And then we'll see.
Well, it would be good to have something happen there that contributes to the vitality of the village.
Do you have the right to reject any offers?
Well, we did the last time, Marty, and I inked it out here, but the town attorney said you might want to reconsider that and reject some bad offers. Offers that, you know, require some absurd amount of something and don't have any cash attached to them. Huge big contingencies. Just, I know it's not your bailiwick, but do you think that would be wise for us to keep the right to reject any offer on what you need?
I would think so, yeah.
All right, well, we'll talk about that. Okay.
Good.
Thank you very much.
Come.
Okay. Good luck.
Wish us and you.
Yes, thank you.
Success.
Right. Next up is Jocelyn Herrick with suggestions for the regulation revisions from the Board of Health Commission.
So if you want to agenda these point by point,
Sure. I think that would be pretty good.
Why don't you make sure Jocelyn's got the microphone?
Oh, good idea.
Well, thank you again, and the commission is also, the Salisbury Rural Housing Commission, grateful for your consideration of the recommendations that they made on the zoning regulations. So I'll just go through these. Mm-hmm. I think some of them we discussed a little bit at the last the public hearing, but.
Right. And maybe we'll comment on each one.
Sure. Yes. Some of them, many of them are just points of clarification, and a few of them are obviously things that need more in-depth study and consideration, and the commission is happy to help with that, and just wanted to express that. So the first one is about maximum floor area allowed for an accessory apartment, and you know, I have Tom McGowan's comments as well on these suggestions. I think the issue was that there was a lack of clarity about what the maximum floor area for an apartment in a principal dwelling was. And Tom clarified for me that there is actually no maximum floor area anymore. So that's great. But I guess I would ask still that somehow be a little, I mean, it wasn't clear to me reading it that that was the case. And I wonder if it could be stated that there is no maximum floor area requirement for an apartment in a principal dwelling.
I think it was, our discussion was the opposite, that there had to be a minimum amount for the homeowner.
Mm-hmm. But not a maximum.
600, whatever the state law was, 600.
350.
Whatever.
Yeah, right.
Because we've had quite extensive debate about that. space, there shouldn't be a maximum if they wanted.
Right.
80% of the building, and you still have, still met the.
Well said, yeah.
Which is great, and we totally agree with that.
So your suggested language is not what you really want, you just want to clarify that there is no maximum.
Right, because I didn't, I thought there was, I thought, I was just trying to clarify what the maximum area was, and I much prefer, yeah, not to add this, what I suggested, but instead to clarify by saying there is no maximum floor area requirement for an apartment in the school.
Right.
Just again, you all went through all the process of discussing that.
You sure did.
Know what you decided, but from an outsider's perspective, the second suggestion was that there be some kind of description of what's meant, what is required in terms of minimum kitchen facilities in an apartment. And I think Tom agreed that that would be fine as a note in the regulations. And so if you, you all are okay with that, that would be, you know, again, the purpose is for anybody looking at the regulations trying to figure out whether they can afford to create an apartment or not, for them to know that they don't have to have a full size refrigerator and full range and you know, full stove and oven and everything might make a difference to people. So
that would go in the paragraph under H, access, which
no, it's up to you. Tom suggested it just be a note, I guess, on that page, it sounds like. But whatever, however you feel like it.
Well, I think it should come out of H, because it doesn't have anything to do with that.
Well, that's what I was thinking, too. I thought we should
name sure why it's in there.
Yeah, unless we made H access and facilities. And then have them both under H. But that's kind of a discussion for later in the day, anyway. Exactly how we do that. But
we have a list of minimum utility installation requirements in our zoning application form. No, I think so.
Well, no, that's what Justin's saying. We don't, so I don't even know why it's.
That's why we suggested it be taken out, because it's not actually there.
Not sure why it's even in there.
Yeah, for
it's in there for the
historical
building.
Context, Marty will remember this. When Marty and Bill Morrow were working on that on the Affordable Housing Commission, the preferred solution seemed to be, talking to P&Z, was that it would be in the application. I think that since Tom had felt, but maybe Nancy and others have felt that actually wasn't a good place to put it, we don't really care as long as it's very apparent to someone who's simply picking up the regs, thinking about whether they want to do an accessory apartment. They need to know that going in, so they don't say, oh, we're going to have, they make the wrong assumption about having a full kitchen facility. So I don't think we really care where it appears as long as it's quite prominent that to someone just picking up the regs and looking at it
right
before they've even come to you or thought about an application.
I think it should just come out.
It could have been completely. I mean, what would we have to say about kitchen enforcement? We don't do that with houses.
No.
I mean, people know what they have to put into them. I mean, why are we saying minimum utility?
I'd also add, too, that I think we should be careful about this kind of language, because encouraging people to have countertop burners may be a fire code situation in a multi-unit dwelling. Because as soon as you put an accessory on it, if you're in the primary building, you're in a multi-unit. And we could be actually encouraging people in a direction we don't want them going. I think it's best not to, the thing stands as it is. They'll have to decide what that kitchen is. For us to encourage that type of appliance specifically, I would object to it.
I mean,
that's a fire hazard.
I may be missing something. How is a countertop burner more dangerous than a full range.
It can be knocked off the counter onto the floor with hot water in it.
And you mean like a countertop burner, a hot plate, that type?
I was assuming it was built.
Okay.
I was assuming it was built in, it just.
Built as well, too, right?
In other words, you could have countertop burners with a microwave.
I mean, to define a countertop burner in this, you're gonna put this in. What I saw was a portable, that's what came to my mind.
But the problem is that's not really in our jurisdiction. And.
Right.
And what also seems very strange when you look at this is why is this even being discussed under access?
Yeah, that's what we're saying, public hearing.
Yeah.
So we need to see that entire.
Yeah.
But what you're looking for is clarification. I understand what you're looking for, but I guess everybody so far is saying it doesn't fit in the zoning regulation. Does it therefore fit on a zoning application form, which was the intent here, and is that the way to fix this, to put it asterisked on the zoning application form?
You could have said
that was our original idea, but for some reason that.
Didn't happen.
It didn't go that way. But that was, I think, Marty, am I mistaken? I thought that was the original idea that maybe Nancy came up with, that you put it in the application.
No, I don't remember that. I mean, when people come in and discuss an accessory apartment, 9 times out of 10, they ask the question, do I need a full refrigerator? Do I need a range or whatever? I say, for zoning purposes, I don't care. The building code determines if I say you can have a microwave, all right, you want a microwave, but you don't want a stove. The building and safety code might say otherwise. You have to have a full-size stove.
See, our concern.
The two codes don't necessarily always agree.
Our concern was that we didn't want somebody who was just starting to think about an accessory apartment to pull up the zoning regs online, look at it, and make the assumption that they were, boy, we better plan on a full kitchen, full refrigerator, full range, dishwasher.
I haven't had that happen. They usually come in and talk to us.
Okay, but if.
But if they didn't, then I see where you're going.
But then what do you, yeah, see, the problem is the people who don't come in to talk to you because they just say, this is going to be really expensive.
Some regulations, it's a use. The use is an accessory apartment.
It's an accessory apartment.
And what you put in that accessory apartment is up to you.
But we are saying that it has to be equipped with its own kitchen, bath, and utilities.
Yeah, that's right.
Exactly. That's where we start. We said, okay, what's a kitchen?
Right.
And
right.
If you assume a full kitchen, that's a lot more expensive than if you have a microwave.
Just microwave.
Yeah.
We talked about this after tonight. Mm-hmm. But the word itself, people come to mind at the next point.
I did get this language, by the way. What other zoning commissions do necessarily need to set it. You know, but for what it's worth, I got this language from another zoning regulation.
Which wording?
I got some of the wording on the minimum kitchen requirements, like the cubic feet of the
refrigerator.
I think it's probably a pretty good idea. What,
yeah.
What you're thinking on that, what you're putting in.
So the third suggestion was about the table of uses in commercial zones, multifamily dwellings, which is up to 3 units, as you know, are allowed by special permit in C20 and C220. But town or nonprofit affordable housing developments are not permitted in those zones. And, Tom has a lot of comments on this, which I agree with. It's obviously a bigger question about what uses you want to allow in the commercial, the limited commercial areas that you have in the village centers. You know, the tricky part is I was looking at the town and nonprofit sponsored housing regulation section in there, and it says that it obviously prefers those to be built on town water and sewer, and most of the area is covered by town, much of the area covered by town water and sewer is in the commercial zones. I think, so, you know, I'm not sure how best to discuss it or help the commission now or in further discussions figure out where, how you want to move forward on that. From a planner's perspective, it makes all the sense in the world in commercial areas, especially on Main Street, to have at least the first floor be commercial and not allow first floor residential. So I totally agree with that sentiment. It's just that there are areas in the commercial zones that are set back that could potentially be used for multifamily and for affordable housing. So I just think, you know, by special permit, you know, if a proposal could be brought and then met the, you know, zoning commission's requirements, seems like that would make sense to allow it by special permit. That's just our opinion.
Yeah. That's sort of a tough nut to crack, I guess. Where to allow them, where to draw a line. Yeah.
But you're sort of limiting so much of the downtown villages where
I thought
it might be appropriate for the blanket set.
Mm-hmm. I remember having some discussions throughout this process about that issue, not necessarily before we have it, but just in areas of the regulations we talk about. Nonprofit uses versus for-profit uses. And really, you shouldn't have anything to do with whether it's for-profit or not-for-profit. If you're allowing the use in the zone, it should be allowed for
right. Right.
And maybe this is just an area where it got overlooked.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there's other areas that we need to look into for the same issue. I mean, we had that issue with signs.
Mm-hmm.
That, you know, not-for-profit signs were allowed. You know,
right.
So throughout the regulations, I think we just need to take a broader look at that whole issue.
Mm-hmm.
Deciding regulations by for-profit or not-for-profit doesn't mm-hmm. really make sense. It's the use of the land.
I don't know if you want to hear my argument about it, but I guess you could argue that there are public purposes served, additional public purposes served by creating additional market rate housing might not provide. But personally, I think anything that creates units that are in village center and smaller and more affordable by nature, even if they're not de-restricted, would be.
Yeah. I'm in agreement.
Yeah.
I'm not
yeah.
disagreeing with you.
Yeah.
I'm just saying there shouldn't be restrictions to one or the other.
Mm-hmm.
It's in different areas of town. Permitted for one type of entity should be allowed. Yeah.
Right. Well, commercial development would be allowed, and nonprofit would be disallowed.
Right.
Okay. So or vice versa.
I feel like the question here, and actually goes with the next recommendation, is does it make sense to allow, at least by special permit, higher densities, you know, a greater number of units, whether they're affordable or not, in the commercial zones, because they are in village centers where there's town water and sewer. And so, as you know, the next recommendation is about whether to consider allowing more than three units in a multifamily. And it's really to get to the same point, which is, you know, that the Housing Commission believes that we need more units that are affordable by nature or by restriction, and those units are generally, it is easy. easier to do those units in multifamilies. You know, again, we know it's a big question of trying to think about the impacts of allowing more than three units. We understand as Tom says, traffic impacts, sewer impacts. And so, you know, I guess we just wanted to express that we'd be happy to help in any way we can. If there's some way we can try to help think about a build-out kind of study, to think about what would happen if you allowed up to four units, what's the impact on traffic and sewer capacity, and if you allow it in these specific zones, you know, if something like that makes sense, we'd be happy to either help or comment or we understand it's a big question.
The sewer question is, as I understand it, the Water Pollution Control Authority is doing a study about the capacity of the sewage system, and we really don't know how much capacity there is at this point with some of the stuff that's leaking in, groundwater and roof water. So until we get that information, it's kind of hard to really move forward, it seems like.
But I think it's difficult to assume a problem when we don't know. And what I know from the study is that they may end up increasing capacity as much as finding any other sorts of problems because of fixing leakages and so on.
Right.
Some of the purposes of it, and we may find we have significantly more capacity than we think we do. So I think we just don't know.
We just don't know.
To see us, you know, waiting 2 or 3 years to do anything because we don't know. And we don't know that we have a problem. And we may have less of a problem, but have more of a problem.
Well, we had that request coming from the Bureau of Alderman a couple of years ago to change it from 3 to 6.
Yeah.
Is that
the one from a few years ago?
Yeah.
Building my phone.
Yeah. And it was on the to-do list, and now it's at the top of the to-do list. Because of Justin.
The matter is just putting that on the to-do list because what's interesting to me is a lot of our older apartment buildings in this town, in fact, have 6 or 7 units in them. And there's a number of them, and most people don't notice them. I live in one, everyone thinks it's a big old grand house.
Yeah.
They don't even recognize the idea that everyone I say, that's an apartment building, has been for a long time.
Right.
You don't even know.
And as an ambulance driver, I know there are many more that you never see because I'm up in the woods.
That's the great thing. You know, I think that speaks volumes. That speaks more than any study, quite right? But they're sitting all around us and we don't even see them. That's the impact.
And
they were. And they were. That's the impact. So I think it's worthy of consideration.
Right.
There's no doubt I'm on the record saying that we need to increase that for multiple sakes, and affordable housing is one of them.
We can give you chapter and verse on the demand for rental housing that we can't meet. At the present time, it's high and getting higher for a lot of economic reasons. You can understand people being scared away from single family ownership, but not having the financial resources they once had for single family ownership. So the housing trust is sort of dead in its tracks a bit because they don't have any applicants. Well, you know, they don't have any applicants to buy a single family house. And we're inundated monthly with people who want rentals.
Mm-hmm. Is there any thought that we could get some kind of a preliminary read on the capacity of the sewer system?
You would think that they designed it to be at a certain capacity.
You would think so.
It'd be nice to know what the capacity is. Yes, we have leaks. If they fix the leaks, we're going to have more room. We know they're going to fix the leaks. It may take 2 or 3 years. You would think that there was, when the darn thing was built, that they would know what the capacity was supposed to be.
Depends on whether it's leak out or leak in. Right?
Right. But at the time it was designed with no leaks,
right,
there's a capacity. Yeah. What's the build-out system? You would think we could get something.
Well, we had something for the planning development, didn't we? Didn't we have a report from John Williams?
As me being an alternate to a water pollution control authority board, I will go ask the question.
Would be wonderful.
You're on the board?
I'm an alternate.
Oh, well, that's an alternate question.
Yeah.
Why don't I just go ask it? There's got to be something.
Share the answer with us, we'd appreciate it.
1950, 1960, they probably had an idea what the capacity was.
Right. And.
Be sure the selectmen and the board of housing commission too.
But we know it's going to improve.
Yeah.
Because we're going to fix the leaks.
The leaks in.
Yeah.
The leaks in.
And we don't have a huge problem now, so I mean, I just.
Because what we're dealing with is stormwater runoff.
Yes.
It's leaking in, really.
It's leaking in. Every time it rains, the flow goes up.
Right.
So if you allowed, for example, town and nonprofit sponsored affordable housing in those two commercial zones, I guess my question is, if you allowed them by special permit, could you not turn it down if in fact they couldn't prove that there was the sewer capacity to deal with it? I mean, is it part of your review and special permit process that they've mitigated any impacts?
It's part of the review to get approval of.
Right.
But it sounds like.
You don't go to the town sewer and ask the question.
No, I go to John Will and then he presents a report that says, yes, it's okay for this.
To add this number.
To add this number of units.
So then you would know that there was the capacity.
Right.
So I guess I'm just wondering what the harm would be in allowing it by special permit.
Right. So it's up to him to determine that there is enough capacity.
He and his board of directors or commissioners, whatever they are, say yes or no.
Right.
And I get something in writing.
And they tell us that they can't determine that because the study's not finished, so we'll look back to us. Pass the buck.
But they haven't done that.
Yeah, we'll figure it out. I mean, it's got to be.
They haven't done.
Nancy, they haven't done that yet.
No, they haven't. Never, ever, ever.
Okay, so.
So we could talk about number four and again, if there's any other way that we can help think about moving into six. Do you have any specific suggestions? The next one. Because as an outsider, I don't understand. understand that I don't still have to look back at these setback requirements and meet them.
But if you're not building it.
You're not building it.
You don't need to.
But okay, say my house isn't already 15 feet from the line. I'm just saying, I'm just explaining what, again, I'm not you guys, I don't sit behind this table every day. But as somebody looking at this, trying to figure out whether I can do this in my house, I mean, I don't know, I mean, I'm only one opinion, but when I read it, I can understand.
The commission had the same problem.
That if I looked at the setback requirements back in the back, that my house didn't have to already meet those, or else I couldn't convert.
Yeah, it's just a clarification, really.
Yeah.
And the commission looked at it, and they all had the same problem with it.
Yeah.
Right?
I think that sentence would help.
Everything Jocelyn was raising, by the way, was unanimously agreed by the commission, so she's leaving for the commission. She's not off on a frolic of her own, as the lawyers like to say.
Okay.
Clarity is good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, you guys are looking at it more fresh than we are, and you see things that are, you know, than an applicant might be confused by it too.
Exactly.
So number six, that this recommendation was about considering adding a regulation like corn malls, which basically allows someone to break off a 1 acre lot from their larger lot and basically give it to the town or a nonprofit to create an affordable house. And it's been successful in Connecticut, or sorry, in Cornwall. I can't remember, I think they've done like 12, do you remember how many?
Something like that.
And I'm going to create about 12 units in Cornwall with this regulation. So yes.
Well, it's been very successful.
What do the people get for giving their lot to the town?
Get a tax deduction.
Tax deduction. That's it.
That's it.
What do you have written here? It's different to me than what you just said. What you just said was they could have a basically a free split of a 1 acre minimum acre lot for this purpose. And this is just saying that if they want to do that, it has to be a minimum 1 acre. There's nothing in here about subdividing or splitting up a lot. Which is a big issue.
Well, they're already allowed the second cut or first cut?
First cut.
Right now you're allowed the first cut. Well, now it's not
first cut.
Right.
As long as you meet the zone.
And this is saying, like, for example, if you were in a 2 acre zone, you could cut out a 1 acre.
Well, that's what I'm not seeing. That's why I'm asking the question. Because if you're asking for an exception to the 2 acre lot rule,
doesn't that make it more non-conforming?
Yeah.
That's
not what I'm saying. It's not. That's why I'm asking the question. The discussion is different than the written words. I just wonder which way you want to go. You want to go to what you're talking about, or you want to go to what you're reading?
Well, this, all I did with this is this is basically, again, as you know, it's hard to take something from somebody else's regulations and make it work.
They have 5 acre zone.
Five.
And they allow it to do a 1 acre in a 5 acre zone.
Yeah. You want to do it in smaller zones.
So that's the difference.
Jocelyn, Tom was originally at the time of our committee, he was originally going to look at the Sharon and Cornwall regs, and I think I understand that he preferred the Cornwall option. They're similar. And I thought he was going to draft something that was appropriate for the Salisbury regs. Did he recommend
that?
In
his recommendations, he just said, this is what Cornwall has. I would recommend you consider.
Okay.
And all I did was, you know, change the town's core call to the town of Salisbury. I didn't look at where it fit into your regulations because I didn't know whether you would want to think about it or not, so.
And I think the discussion is good. The way I read this was that you could spin off your lot for tax benefit reasons for this purpose, not that you would subdivide for this purpose. I mean, there's, we can have a discussion for both ways, but I mean, I think it would make sense in Cornwall that a 5-acre lot could split up one, but if you have a 2-acre lot and you split it in half, that doesn't make sense.
Could we ask Tom to, since he recommends it, to make sure it's appropriate for Salisbury?
Well, it's just taking a conforming lot and turning it into non-conforming.
No, I understand your concern, and I don't have an answer to it, but I just wonder if maybe Tom could.
I do think that the two or three that I've seen in Cornwall, the remaining portion of the land
is still
in no case ever was non-conforming.
No, I understand. That's why it makes sense in Cornwall. I'm just saying, if you try and take that same regulation, you put it in
a
2-acre zone, they have a bigger problem.
They do have 2-acre zones. They do have 5-acre zones. So it's not, you know, it's not 5-acre zones level. You know, there are some village areas where it's.
Have they done it in the 2-acre areas?
I can't tell you for sure.
Okay. So maybe if Jim is offering to get Tom's comments on how it could be related to our situation, why wouldn't we accept that offer?
I don't know. It's my prerogative to do that, but maybe we'll do it whatever way you like. Because it sounds like he simply said, yes, I think this is a good idea for Salisbury, but John and others are raising questions.
I just think it needs more discussion.
I agree.
If you want to do that throughout the entire town.
Yeah,
and that's why not conformity, but maybe there's an area in town that would work for that purpose.
And Tom isn't here to comment on that. I was just saying. He presumably understands Cornwall and Sharon and Greg's and who's recommended this, but you have some really good questions that I don't see answered.
Yeah, the places I've seen are out of the village centers on a bigger chunk of property where someone took a corner of their wood land or their farmland and just said,
yeah,
I'd like to have this.
So these are on their own septic systems as well.
Yeah, they are. They're all.
We've been trying to encourage people to do affordable housing on the sewer system.
Right.
It was not created all out there. You know, this, it also, this also comes back, though, to one of your original comments, which I'm very concerned about. This nonprofit can do this and other people can't do that. Inevitably, that legal question is going to come to haunt some of these towns when somebody says, well, why are you given special exception? And it's, I'm getting a little leery of all of the defining that, you know, a nonprofit can do this.
For what it's worth, I agree with Mike very much. We want anybody building housing, either by its nature or by restriction, that is affordable to the people in the town. And that can be for profit developers if you can simply find ways to attract them.
Isn't that exactly what you're saying?
Yeah,
we're all saying the same thing.
But maybe what we could do is, you know, we're focused on 2-acre lots where maybe we should be focused on multi-acre lots that don't have the building without major cost for a subdivision and allowing a second split for this purpose of the one. Because if we have a lot of properties that, you know, that have 12, 14, or 22 that have been split off in pieces for affordable, and we make the process easier through subdivision, not through zoning. But
Jocelyn, I'm sorry, pulling a blank here, but don't we either have or have in our recommendation something about a second cut for affordable housing?
Yeah.
Has that been enacted? Is that in the current regs? As revised, or is that one of our second phase recommendations?
I'm not sure.
It wasn't in the phase.
You've got to take this one.
Or am I bringing it from another town, because we've talked to a lot of towns?
No, it sounds really familiar, I just can't remember exactly. But it wasn't in the, it certainly wasn't in Tom's first phase.
So we need some plans for the second go.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I would just suggest, and we can check in with Tom, or you can, but, I mean, if you, for example, had it just in the R3 zone, and you required a minimum, you know, that the remaining lot be a minimum of however many acres, then, again, you wouldn't be creating two non-conforming lots. You'd be creating one non-conforming lot for housing.
Yeah.
Who do you want to follow up with, Tom, or you do it, or you want Jocelyn to do it?
I guess.
If we do it, it'd cost us money.
Yeah, he likes Jocelyn.
You know how to do it.
I think he's retired anyway.
I mean, he's moving swiftly to retirement.
Yes. Okay, that's on your to-do list.
Good point, Tom.
And the last point was just, you know, again, I know that there's a space for you for cluster. A cluster regulation. And I don't know what this commission's goals are for cluster regulation, if it's mainly preserving significant open space, critical habitats, that kind of thing. I know in other towns, one of the goals of allowing cluster was having an additional incentive for if some of the units were affordable. My personal professional opinion is that cluster isn't a good way to create, cluster subdivision regulations aren't a good way to create affordable housing. They're a way to create a different kind of subdivision that can, I think, protect open space in a way that typical subdivisions don't. But in any case, I have a lot of, I did a lot of research on it in grad school, and would be happy to share any of that with you if the commission felt like it was useful in terms of various kind of different example regulations and what goals they had and whether they did or didn't.
So your conclusion would be to remove the placeholder?
I guess all I was saying that from my perspective, with my affordable housing hat on, I wouldn't focus energy on a cluster regulation to help with affordable housing. If the goal of the commission is to have a cluster subdivision regulation for preserving open space, that's another conversation, and whether or not it's an effective way to do that and how complicated they are to administer and consider, whatever, that's another issue. But I think there are other good ways to create housing options, and that I don't think cluster subdivisions are. But again, I haven't been in on discussions about what the goal would be with that regulation. So in any case, it was just an offer to help.
Well, that's something we're going to be discussing more or another in the future. We'll appreciate your input.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So next up is Jocelyn Mayer. The assignment on Salisbury Bank.
Yes. So this is with my collaborative hat on. As you know, we've been working on basically various ways of supporting local businesses by trying to direct visitors to them. And one of the things that came up in focus group sessions that we had with business owners a couple of years ago was that there wasn't enough signage to get people there. The collaborative applied for a steep grant on behalf of 7 of our member towns and got $80,000 to help build signage which was designed through a Connecticut Main Street grant that we had gotten. So basically what I wanted to get your advice, opinion about was whether or not this type of sign basically meets your current zoning regulations, or whether you would consider, I know you're considering your, or my understanding is you're considering your signage regulations, so you know, whether you might think about putting in something that would allow it if it doesn't already. So basically this is 4 by 4 foot by 4 foot square. The picture in the bottom corner is what we did in Sharon at the Sharon Shopping Center on the wall there. This one is actually 8 feet long by 4 feet tall, so it wouldn't be that big. But again, the goal would be, the idea is that we put up, kind of inside this, it would basically be a display case like this is. And inside would be a kind of map and directory of the businesses in Salisbury and Lakeville, and where to eat, where to shop, where to stay, where to visit, so that people have a better sense of where they can do those things. And this would be some, because we all know businesses change, phone numbers change, you know, whatever. So the reason, I mean, we could just make this weather tight and tack it up to the wall, but the idea behind having a case is that we can replace this as often as it's necessary to make sure it's updated.
Did you put a date on the Sharon one?
A date?
Is it dated? I mean, Sharon one you can update?
Yeah.
And is there in the material a date so that a visitor can see it was updated in March of 2013 or something?
No, it's just the business owners that will, you know, the ones that aren't on there or are closing, or, you know, that there's a process for getting it updated, basically. And the idea is to update it at least once a year.
And who updates
the one in Sharon is going to be updated by the Sharon Business Association steering committee.
I think they should put a date on
Who's paying for the sign? Is it owned by the town?
The steep grant is funding that goes to the town to for this purpose.
So the town will own the sign?
Yes.
So they maintain it?
On Salisbury Bay's property?
Yes.
But who's chosen that site?
I was looking for a place in that area because, well, frankly, whenever I'm down there at lunchtime, I have often gotten people walking by saying, where do I get a sandwich or whatever. I feel like the alley is a good, you know, people do walk around there as opposed to other places in town. I was trying to look, we did some, at the very beginning of this process, we did some sketches of, like, what if we put a sign out on the lawn, like, kind of like that. And I know that there are a lot of concerns, that there are already a lot of signs out there, so I knew that a solution that didn't add to the cluff, the number of signs in the lawns there would probably be more attractive to people. So I just thought that this would be something that would clutter that area out there, and people would still walk up to it.
Is there any information from the bank as to how many withdrawals they're getting in that ATM that are not local people?
I have not asked that question.
I think that would be very interesting, because to me that's a very strange place for a sign of welcoming visitors to tell. I realize people stop at ATMs.
Well, it's extremely strange for the people on Lakeville.
Yeah. Well, you know, I'm thinking something like the Grove, for instance, where a lot of visitors may come to the Grove in the summer months, might give people a...
Well, our perspective, how many, are there any signs on the building proper down there? Salisbury Bank and Trust does have a sign on the building, does it not? Isn't it at its limit for signs?
Well, she's got to let you know where.
Well, that's self-protected trust property. I mean, you know, if you want to go by regulation, based on what I read, you can't put that.
Well, this is not a, I mean, in my mind, this is a town-sponsored sign. This is how we've dealt with it in every other town that I work with. The town's paying for the sign, the town is doing this in order to support local businesses. And, you know, in the other towns that I've worked with, basically, there is a exemption in the zoning regulations for town-sponsored signs. And so.
Of non-commercial nature.
They allow those under that exemption.
I don't have a problem with the concept of that. I'm more interested in the location of it.
Yeah.
And what?
I mean, if people have a idea about where else to put it, again, I'm just thinking about where people are walking around in a space that doesn't add, something that doesn't add to the clutter of signs that are there. The other location I was thinking of, because I think it would be great to have one in Salisbury Village Center and in Lakeville Village Center, and I talked briefly with Curtis about this, putting one in the entrance to the ball field by the Petco.
By the Petco makes more sense again, because by the ball field is the local people going there, they know it.
Yeah, not in the ball field, but you know, in the entrance to the ball field by the Petco, so that you could actually see it from the road.
Yeah.
And we could, in theory, again, this would add to the sign clutter, which is part of what I'm trying to avoid, but in theory, in the DOT right-of-way, there could be something, a sign that says visitor information with an arrow, pointing them down the alleyway.
And the DOT would have to approve something that's in their right-of-way.
Yeah. I mean, we're in all the other towns doing signs in the DOT right-of-way, and so I'm working with DOT on how they will approve. And it isn't a quick process.
I was going to say, how long does that take?
Yeah.
There's DOT right-of-way. On this Main Street over here, there's a town park between DOT right-of-way and the buildings. You know that? Okay. Just so you know, if you put it in not on DOT property, you may not have to get that.
Yeah.
Well,
again, I just wanted to see, I mean, there is a part of your regulations that say that a town official exercising their duties can put up signs, again, you know.
At intersections and so forth.
It just says they're exempt from.
Well, exercising their duties, now, you've got to define whether this is, because our regulations also prohibit signs of a commercial nature like that, and you're marketing businesses with this, so that's a commercial nature. I mean, you think you need to read a little deeper into the regulations.
I'm not marketing businesses. This is a project.
No, I didn't say you were, but the intention of the sign could be construed as marketing businesses. I'm only looking at the aspect where our regulations say not of a commercial nature, and if it's pointing people to specific businesses, question is that of a commercial nature?
Do the regulations say exception for town-sponsored signs not of a commercial nature? Or do they just say?
Well, we're revamping the sign regulations. So
right, yeah, there's another thing that may change.
And everybody gets on the sign, right? Unless
yeah,
they opt out.
Yeah.
Unless they opt out, everybody gets on and somebody takes responsibility for updating it.
Yeah.
Is there any way to go if it works?
Yeah, right.
If it works to direct people to businesses,
well,
I mean, if you want to wait for 2 years and see how we do in Norfolk and Goshen and Sharon.
I'm not suggesting waiting, I'm just wondering if there's any data, because otherwise it's just another sign sitting there that nobody looks at and pays attention to. I mean, that's been the problem trying to get people into that village center all for many years.
Mm-hmm.
And they have to get in there before they'll walk around and see this. You're talking about changing the whole entryway, it looks great.
Justin, what do you have to think? I might consider it far too sensitive and confidential, but it may just be interesting to know whether visitors are actually using their ATV.
It may be something to know if they really want a sign next to their ATM.
Well, that's true, but I mean, I don't know.
This isn't the base idea, I mean, this is...
Prerequisite.
This is me trying to find a space that might work. And again, I'm bringing this to the town. I only have so much time to spend on this project to help support local businesses. They want to see signs, they have said that it's important to them. You know, I'm bringing it to you. I'd love to hear, I mean, I'd love if there's some problem solving around how we can make this work. If we can't make it work, that's fine, I'll move on. I just, you know, it's working in other towns, we're doing it in other towns, so it can be something that can happen here.
Would you describe this as wayfinding as opposed to commercial nature? I mean, where do you draw the line between those?
Yeah, I mean, I certainly think of it as directing people to the services that are in the
center. Yeah. It's not gonna say, the Quebec's is having 10% off sale this week. It's way fine.
They also have that area that the marketplace is just revamped as the bulletin board and all the informational signs and stuff. What is light field get off this?
Well, the idea is to put one by the ball field for
Lakeville. So it would be two.
Yeah.
Just my own goal again, I have a problem with it. Are the locations of this. I mean, John is saying, is it working? You're saying, well, it's working because you're putting them up. We don't know whether it's working in terms of drawing people in. And fair enough, it hasn't been going on long enough. What we know is we have money and we can spend it on this, right? And I'm not opposed to the concept, but I'd like to better understand the location and how it might work. And you know, maybe Stacy, they'll ask Stacy down the road. I mean, I know it's a seasonal business down there, but it may be interesting in terms of what sort of questions they get from visitors. I know they had 1,400 people there on July 4th, 2 years ago. That's a lot of people that one assumes would quite like to have known what was in Lakeville and what was in Salisbury. And so they may be more useful places to put a wayfinding sign like this, directing, you know, one sign, one place for Lakeville, for the same place, one for Salisbury. Or near the Petco, because that's when people coming into town are going to stop and fill up their car. So location is the issue for me. And then we'll solve the problem of, well, how do we make it work in the regulations?
Mm-hmm.
Location is... With all due respect to Kathy and John, I think the issue of, you know, do they work? People have been asking that question about advertising since advertising was invented, and yet Americans spend trillions of dollars a year on advertising. The fact is that the merchants who we want to have in these towns, they are very much supportive of it, it seems to me. I mean, they're the ones making the judgment that it will help them. I studied this in marketing and business school, and there's no good evidence about advertising. I remember the old saying, you know, when business is good, it pays to advertise. When business is bad, you have to advertise. I mean, that's about as close as people get to whether advertising actually works or not. And yet, we spend, you know, huge quantities of money on it. And I think the fact that the merchants want it, they're hurting in many ways. And the seed grant's been awarded for that purpose, to try and improve business in the small towns. I think that's about all the evidence you're going to get.
I don't think we're saying we don't agree with the concept of helping the local businesses. Mm-hmm. We're just wondering if there's a better way to do it, a better location to do it.
Well, location. Nobody's saying I'm not speaking to location. I'm speaking to the idea and the fact that the merchants want it. It's like this. You're never going to know how effective it is, probably.
Right. Yeah.
If you wait for Goshen and Sharon and so on.
No, I don't think anyone was suggesting it.
Okay, we
got
to
move on. Yeah, why not? Good, I guess we'll
try to run. Did you get your answer?
Well, I think from the zoning perspective, back to Michael's point, is depending on where it's going to go, it has to meet the zoning sign regulations. If it's going to be under the exemption of the selectmen, doesn't have anything to do with this.
Would you interpret your regulations to allow the selectmen to put this sign up here?
Do we change them?
Well, when you change them?
I thought we already had it in the regulations.
They can't.
Well, it's a little unclear.
It's a little unclear. I mean, it says on town owned property and street intersections.
Right.
It doesn't say anything about privately owned property.
Right.
Which is an issue.
Which is why we put those other ones.
Exactly.
Yeah. There's other sections in there too, because, you know, you've got to go through the whole regulation just to even approve that location. And I don't think that location will approve.
I don't.
Based on what I'm looking at sign regs a lot.
I guess I.
Well, we're going to sign regulations next, so it's certainly part of the discussion.
I think that would be great.
Right. Signs erected by a public official in performance of a public duty. It doesn't sound like we're.
That's awesome.
That's not regulated by us.
But is that public duty?
Where in the law does it say it's the selectmen's public duty to promote businesses in town?
Exactly.
Or to help people find their way around the streets?
Right.
So it's not in there.
Is there a definition of what their public duty is?
Of the selectmen's.
That's a.
That's very likely from medical. It's very tiny.
I'm one.
Is in your public duty?
Yeah. Okay, we'll delve into this more.
There's a lot of definitions of what their duties do not include. I've never seen a definition of what they do include.
Yes.
Very, very.
And usually, if it's not in of what they do include, then it means you can't do it.
Right.
Well, I don't. You want me to make a comment during the sign regulation discussion? I mean, in Falls Village, we did actually, for this purpose, pass an amendment to the signage regulations, basically allowing an exemption for a sign that is approved by the Board of Selectmen and the Planning and Zoning Commission. And I think.
By both, right?
Yeah.
Not just the selectmen.
Yeah.
Right.
Good. We'll address that.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Justin.
Thanks, Justin.
Thank you very much.
Right, Matt Beaver and Elizabeth Slough.
Elizabeth and I are here to try to have a brief letter. We have about three questions for the commission on the pre-existing non-conforming lots that are in a approved subdivision, and trying to figure out if they will. Let me just read it real quick. First, thanks for your time to this commission. I know it's a big commission. It's been more than 15 years since I got off the commission. And it was, I had so many conflicts that finally stepped aside. Frequently, I get asked by a landowner through the permitting process pertaining to planning and zoning regulations, subdivision regulations, and conservation commission regulations. My questions this evening are pertaining to the status of lots that are part of an approved subdivision. As we know, in 1957, the town of Salisbury adopted zoning subdivision regulations. In 1959, the zoning regulations. Over the years and up to the present, there have been changes or revisions to these regulations. Presently, I'm trying to advise a client regarding a vacant approved building lots in the town of Salisbury. They've been approved by subdivisions that were done in the 1960s, 1970s. They're being taxed as building lots. But they may not be able to meet the driveway ordinance or regulation. Are they still a buildable lot?
Anything built up there?
No.
Anything? Nothing?
Well, no, this is a separate lot of the subdivision that is a steep lot.
There's a road at the top?
Well, you still got to get off the town road or the subdivision road to get in
into
there.
The driveway. You still have to create.
I'm trying to understand is the subdivision has what in it? It was approved by, has anything
Oh, yeah, there are other lots that have been built.
Okay, that's what I was trying to get, it was...
It's 15, one of them is a 15-lot subdivision, one's a five-lot subdivision.
Okay.
The happens that the remaining lot is the most difficult lot.
That's why.
Okay, and the buildable area, that requirement may not be able to be met. It perks. What do we do with the regulations at the time that the subdivision was, what are the regulations that were in effect at the time of the subdivision in 1960?
We're satisfied.
Or 1970. Now we have new zoning regulations pertaining to subdivision lots, buildable area.
And driveway. Grade and so forth.
What does this person do? Do they use the regulations that were in effect at the time of the approved lot that hasn't changed in shape and size?
So it is illegally non-conforming because...
No, it's not non-conforming, it was approved at that time.
It was approved at that time as a building lot.
I wouldn't call it non-conforming.
And it would be non-conforming now, you're saying?
It could be.
Yeah, right.
It's quite slow. It wouldn't be a non-conforming lot. It would not meet the driveway regulations or would not meet some other new regulation.
Or the buildable area.
It doesn't make it non-conforming.
I don't think so. How do you address this situation? To go forward.
Is there any kind of limitations in the statutes? I know there are limitations on certain types of permits. I mean, this is one area to look at that would say that after you've had a lot approved, if you don't build on it in the next period of time, I'm just asking the question. No.
There's one of us.
There is for a subdivision.
For a subdivision.
If you've got an approval for a road to be built to a 20-lot subdivision, and that all the improvements are not within five years,
right?
The zoning commission is supposed to put notice in the land records. That's just a null and void. If they don't do that, it's a problem.
If the planning commission doesn't put their notice, it's a problem.
Yes.
But that's not the case here. You're talking about subdivisions where a certain number of the lots have been developed, and there are remaining lots that need to be developed, and to what standards should they meet?
Yeah.
Those lots were developed before we adopted our new driveway regulation and before we adopted the new buildable area.
Some a long time before, by the sound of it.
1960s.
Yeah.
1968.
But keep in mind, our driveway regulation and buildable area are only, 3 years old?
Yeah, no, that's what I'm saying.
So are we deeming those lots unbuildable?
Is it? If a subdivision is the approval of just the breakup of the lots and the ingress, egress to the lots, the utilities, etc., it's not necessarily saying that the lot will stay buildable in perpetuity if the regulations change. If you haven't built on the lot.
But you mean
no, it's a building lot.
It's an approved building lot. It's got the map has a signature of the Planning and Zoning Commission saying that it was approved in 1968.
For a building. But no one built on it.
Right. And they've been taxed on it as a building lot.
Yeah. Also, they've owned the lot since that time.
Well, it's changed hands a couple of times.
But it's always been under owners.
Yeah, it hasn't changed shape and size. The description's the same.
What were you and Nancy? John and Nancy were saying, well, you can't what?
You can't.
You cannot take away an approved building lot. Right.
No, the lot itself.
The lot itself is...
The regulations of how you use that lot. Right. You know, if you haven't used it, it's kind of like if you haven't built your house. You got it approved and it met the building codes 5 years ago and you planned it, but you haven't built it yet. 5 years down the road, you go to build it, and now it doesn't meet the building code.
Sounds like you need some kind of legal opinion.
I'd say so,
yeah. It's almost the same as the discussion on CG20. We're talking about somebody grandfathered.
Yeah.
And can continue to use.
It's an important thing because if
using it for that use.
If your opinion is that it's not a buildable lot, then this person's out of luck.
I don't think you can take someone's.
I don't think you can. And if you are going to say that it's a not buildable lot, could we get something that says that it's not buildable lot?
No, I think we need legal opinion.
Yeah, it's a legal opinion.
And it needs a waiver from certain other regulations.
So.
But also maybe it's a question of when it changed hands. I don't know, but if somebody bought the property after the regulations changed,
the driveway to meet our.
I disagree with that.
No, I just, I don't know, you're not the lawyer, but question mark is.
To the standards of 1960.
You know, if they bought a lot without seeing that the driveway regulations would allow them to put a driveway in, or whatever, then that is.
I have valid points, that's why, Mr. Chairman, I think this really needs to go. There's a lot of questions here that could be argued, and I don't think any of us are really qualified to really look in. I'd ask for a legal opinion on this, or suggest that we ask for a legal opinion.
Yeah, yeah.
I guess there's a lot of, I don't really want to say too much more because of where we sit, and a lot of questions here.
Yeah.
Which leads me to, over a period of time, the zoning and subdivision regulations change with revisions. I have witnessed in my time frame as a land surveyor, I have witnessed where research had to be done as to see what type of regulations were in existence at the time of the creation of the parcel or the issuance of a zoning permit. What type of documentation do you have other than telling the applicant to go through the zoning regulations, meeting this, to see the changes that have happened over time for lot size, buildable area?
They're listed in the vault. Every time there's a change to the regulations, the date it was changed and what was changed in those.
Okay, you know what I'm trying to say?
It hasn't happened in the last.
I don't know, do they list what was changed? No, they just list when the revision was, and you have to take the old copy and put the new copy beside it and find it yourself.
Where are those old copies of the 1960s?
They're in the town clerk's office.
And that's why I used to, which the commission decided not to do, when we changed a regulation, I would put it in parentheses, effective with the date on it. But then in this rewriting of the zoning regulations, the commission opted not to do that.
I didn't know we opted not to.
Yes, it was a discussion.
Yes,
and we
was.
Had it,
right.
And you folks decided not to do that. And I thought that would have been the perfect place to put it, so you wouldn't have to search and search and search.
Isn't that the purpose of this? That this is the new
funding
regulations, and you would implement what you're talking about when there's this next change for sign regulations or next change for CG20?
Yes, but not everything in this was changed. Like, you may go through a set of zoning regulations and change only the signage. Now, the signage is going to have a later date than when this was approved.
Right. Oh,
so by the signage regulations, you would say effective.
Right, but that's what I'm agreeing with you. Mm-hmm. What I'm saying happened going forward, not going backwards.
Right.
Because this is the starting point.
That's correct. But I used to do it when we changed them prior to this, and then folks said, no, don't do it.
What did you used to do that we decided you wouldn't do?
Well, we did the buildable area.
Right.
We added that to our zoning regulations. Right. In parentheses, I would say effective date June 5th, 2009.
In the copy.
So that buildable area.
You knew that regulation took effect that date.
Well, and on the 302 minimum buildable area, it does say effective date.
Right.
3/10/10.
Right.
But what happens to lots that were created before that? That are approved subdivisions.
Right.
No, we understand the question. We're just saying we can't answer that.
I understand that. I understand that, but do you have enough information with this letter? Do you have enough information to?
I don't have page 2 of that.
Well, I mean, how many different examples of this do you have?
I have, in my time, 10. At the moment, I have 2.
At
What happened to the other eight, as a matter of interest?
I don't know yet.
So another page, please.
So what sort of time frame are we talking about that you've had 10 in the last year?
No, no. I have this question asked all the time.
And people just go away? They don't pursue it?
Sometimes, because the cost is too minimal, because they have to hire an engineer. They have to see, go through a whole study. Everybody got a page two?
I've got two page, page two.
I've got page one and page two.
Okay.
You
have
one
of those? Mm-hmm. I thought it was
still working. I have two pages. Okay.
What do you got, John?
He's got the correct one. He's good.
Martin?
I'm good. I've got two pages here.
Well,
I think this is enough information to send.
Because what's a building lot cost in the town of Salisbury? And if it's unbuiltable, if it's vacant land and somebody wants to sell it, and a person is looking at it and saying, well, I want to be able to know what criteria I have to look at it at. Is it a under the current regulations, or is it the regulations that were in effect at the time the lot was created?
I think we can send this to Chuck, and if he has more questions, if he needs more detail, he'll let us know.
Yeah.
Right?
Do you think 30 days? You don't know.
So
what?
To get an answer.
What's the question?
Oh, 30 days to get it.
Yeah,
I don't think so. Yes, you think so, yes.
I mean, I'll work on it tomorrow and send it off tomorrow.
We should be able to get an answer in 30 days.
Oh, yeah.
We should be able to have it by the next meeting.
Mm-hmm. I would think so.
It's important, though.
He's usually pretty quick, isn't he? Yeah.
I don't think it's going to take him long to opine, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Shoot for 2 weeks at the most 30 days.
Right.
I think that's what happened.
It's reasonable. I also am just wondering what would be required for one of these pre-existing lots in order to, if it's not going to go back to what the regulations were when the lot was created and it has to meet the current, there is an exception for lots that were created prior to the buildable lot. And it does allow that. For lots of legal existing prior to 310, the commission new structures that cannot be placed in the buildable area may be constructed provided that special permit is obtained from the commission. In deciding on a special permit, the commission may impose such conditions that most closely conform to the buildable area requirements. And when it says may, does that give the commission leeway? Because sometimes to get the closest to what's required, it means building at the top of the hill rather than on the slope, which, if it's a 10-acre lot, you're forcing people to go all the way to the top and put a house up there. That might be the solution.
That's the benefit of the special permit process, so that we redo all the characteristics that influence your decision.
And then in presenting that with the owner, need to survey just the area where they believe would be the best spot for the house, or would they need to get a survey of the whole property? And once you get into the slopes, it's kind of tough to evaluate unless you do a survey.
Well, it sounds like maybe we would have a preliminary discussion about it and give you an idea of what we thought we would need.
And you could ask for a waiver of the full way to them and just do it by segment.
Mm-hmm.
If it probably some places on that lot probably possibly you couldn't build if you wanted to, so why survey that? I mean, it's a waste of money.
That's the question that usually happens is the study that has to be done to see if you can get a zoning permit and a building permit is not because it could. If let's say it's a 10-acre site, if it's a $3,000 survey and a $7,000 engineering to see if you can build, it's a $10,000 question.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And that's without hiring an attorney.
And if this is a lot that is for sale and the purchaser is caught in this conundrum, does that become a condition for the sale, that first they have to come and get pre-approval, but can you give pre-approval to a lot that they don't own, so does the seller have to go through that?
But meanwhile, it's an approved building.
Yeah.
Well, we're gonna move on getting that legal.
And let's say that the commission may allow by special permit structured and septic systems outside of buildable area. So even if the lot does have, you know, a buildable area that conforms, you can get a special permit to go outside. But then it says, if the placement will result in less grading and other disturbances to natural environment or preserve a scenic view or significant natural feature. I'm just wondering, are those the only conditions? Because there may be some other reasons, I can't come up with them right now, but beyond what's stated, that could make more sense to, you know, put it outside of the area.
I mean, they're all sort of site-specific, so it's kind of hard to answer that.
Every piece of land has got its a problem.
And this to me seems a little too specific, like it's not general enough to think that.
But the part of the special permit is to
get around all the specifics.
Provide solutions.
Provide a solution.
Right.
There seems to be, on larger subdivisions, there seems to be always one lot that never sells.
It's always
one. And now, people are trying to say, well, it's an approved subdivision and it's marginal land. We've got these zoning regulations. This is interesting. I don't know what I'm going to do. And hence, here we are. And I think it's going to be something that's going to come up. You know, one of the good things about the newest regulations is that you don't have to have the minimum lot size of dry land soils anymore. You just have to have no wetland soils in your rural area. That's a huge thing. Mm-hmm. That was a problem several times in the last 15 years with working with clients. All of a sudden they couldn't do it because they didn't have enough dry land soils.
Right,
which says that would have been a new regulation that came in after the subdivision regulations of the 1957 or something?
No, that regulation only came in the 1990s.
Yeah, but now you're just saying that you're going back to a different example of what you've brought forward to us today.
Oh yeah. I'm just saying.
They couldn't build on the lot.
We'll send it up.
Because it was mainly a health department issue. Because of.
Rather than a town BNZ. Well, but you're talking about dry soils and. Oh, because of the pervious.
And the setbacks.
Okay.
75 foot distance setback.
Okay.
I don't think it's a late night. I don't think
we're going. Okay. Well, some poor people are waiting to see this side of the
view. Yeah.
No, I have these conundrum questions.
What?
You always have these.
Yeah.
Reality, right?
The reality. Where we fit. Thank you.
Thank you, Matt.
Okay. Next up, some very patient people here for site plan review.
Hello.
Hello.
I'm here tomorrow.
I'm sorry we had to wait so much.
Oh, no. I appreciate being able to have your time.
I will just briefly say this is a this application is here because it is in the lake overlay.
Lake overlay district.
And actually, that's not checked on the zoning permit application form.
No,
I know that. I have the original, and it will be corrected.
Okay. Thank you.
The proposed deck is within 220 feet of that, is in 220 feet of that 300 foot buffer.
Mm-hmm.
Very small deck, as you can see, 8 by 33 by 8 feet tall. Town water, town sewer. So, and I made a scaled down version of the site plan. So this is Morales here.
Yeah. So thank you, Ian. The project is, we need to replace a front door assembly, so it's in the front of the house facing away from the lake, not on the lake side. It's to replace the front door and then add a front porch that would be 8 feet deep and across the front of the house, 3 feet, 3 feet wide.
It doesn't look like a problem, does it?
No, not at all.
So I think it's
not at all, but because she's in the buffer,
yeah, that's on the problem. She's waited on that.
Well, I wanted to.
But there's not more requirements in that area that aren't met with the site plan. But that's been my argument all along. You have some situations like this, the amount of work that's required to do to meet the requirements and regulations for meeting that site plan. Quite onerous.
I mean,
you have to mark the trees that are, forget all the language now, but there was, I went through it.
With your sunroom?
Like the sunroom on an existing deck.
Mm-hmm.
You know? I'm not suggesting we require that, but somehow we have to, if we're going to approve this, we have to waive the requirements of that overlay protection zone.
I think eventually the commission should come up with a minor site plan for in the overlay protection zone for projects like this versus a major site plan for whole new structures where soil is going to be disturbed and what have you. That's really.
Or trees are being taken down.
Or trees are being taken down and vegetation is being. Nothing is changing. No trees are being added. Nothing is being taken down other than what you have to take down. It's and just a couple of things, but.
Okay, so John, in answer to your question, is there a sheet that says what has to be in the site plan?
Yeah.
Yeah, and if you look at the length overlay protection zone, in theory, it's in our zoning regulations. I mean, it has a whole list of topography and all that other stuff that we really need to revisit and take a look at. We have not done the couple other minor ones we've had. We've done this exact same way.
Okay. So there's a precedent there.
There's a precedent.
That's not true.
Not for you. Yeah. Well, it's not a precedent, but.
Well, I'm just saying it's not accurate.
Well, we just had one we did the same way.
In the overlay protection zone. I'm not disagreeing that it shouldn't be that way.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just saying, if we're going to do this, we have to make some comment to 404.5.
Mm-hmm. Give me a page, please, John.
It's section 404.5, and it has all the overlay district requirements, A through
page 45.
L. And I know when we did this, it was for not this kind of project.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm agreeing with Nancy that when you have these small issues, but I just don't know
how
we satisfy it without at least addressing it in the motion to approve this modified site plan, unless it's just as simple as that. It's a question to you guys.
I thought there was some language about waiving certain requirements. But page 45,
mm-hmm.
404.5.
Yeah.
Or, you know, she asked for the waiver of those requirements and we agreed to it.
Yeah,
not trying to make it problematic.
Just do that and then come back and sort this problem.
Yeah,
another time.
I remember saying that after I went through it because it was just.
Well, after you went through
it. It was just so ridiculous. It was.
And I think you asked for waivers.
No, I didn't.
No?
Because I didn't want to because I was on the commission.
Okay.
So I just met all the requirements.
Mm-hmm.
But for those kinds of issues, they're just a bit over the top. So. Do we need architectural drawings? Is everybody happy with the front porch and this site plan?
It looks pretty thin. Were you going to have any architectural
drawings? Yeah, I have.
Okay. Sorry if I made
that. This is the front view. It's a front porch that spans. the front door. Looking from a floor pin, a plan usually the steps going down. What's on the inside of the house, how the new door will look on the inside. I think I'm probably of interest. There will be four post pillars. So this shows the requirements for how to construct those pillars. This house, and then this is a side view showing the slope of the roof of the porch. So the house we're talking about was a Berkshire home. You know, it was built by the Berkshire Home Company from Falls Village.
Mm-hmm.
In the 1984 or something like that. So the person who's done this plan is Jeff Lindstrom, who worked for that company, who actually was designing those houses and actually knew about this house. So. But we do have, so we have plans for construction.
Okay, so. Would you need those anyway in order to get your building?
Yes, this is right. In preparation for the building plan.
You're not disturbing more than 500 square feet.
Mm-hmm.
Right, so you should make that one.
Yeah.
Well, what hasn't she made in the material that's come home tonight?
We don't have any impervious surface calculations. We don't have soil and erosion plans.
I'm just
suggesting that we waive those requirements. Understanding what's happening. I just don't think we can approve it as meeting the overlay district requirements in a motion when we don't.
Okay. Well, I think we can waive the impervious surface one when we look at the size of the lot, the section in the house, in a way that. But okay.
We have about 10,000 square feet.
We want to.
With an earth drive and.
Could we say something like we approve the site plan and agree that we waive the requirements in 404.5 because of the minimal
scope of the project.
The scope of the project.
Yeah.
Minimal scope of the project.
Excellent.
Okay, good. Done.
That was a motion, Fred. Right?
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's a motion?
Yeah.
I'll second.
Okay, second.
Who's taking the vote? Nancy, did you get that motion down? So you
I have it here, so I will have it.
Okay, fine.
Yeah, and. Of course, Nancy will be responsible for seeing to it that the landscape fencing and hay bales will be appropriate to prevent
sediment.
Yeah. Okay. Any discussion?
We have.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Yeah, when I'm thinking of the bigger problems, definitely the
small
stuff comes in. Yeah, the requirement.
Yeah. The major ones or stuff.
Yeah. Okay. Well, it's getting pretty late and.
Hot.
Yeah.
Hot
school.
Yeah. Hold on. Do you want to back up?
No, we're going to go on.
Yeah. I guess, you know, it would be good to touch briefly on the regulatory priority list and timeline and also the sign regulation discussions. I think two items that Michael had mentioned to me that he has some concern with was the Milton Horizons situation. Where they've exceeded their maximum residency at this point and want to expand some more. And that's kind of a conundrum. Also, there was the line mark regulations that John had been working on. As far as timelines are concerned, I guess, my take on the fact that the comprehensive revision took a long time. We got to a good place with them. But, moving forward, looking at these other issues, I think we just have to plug away at them until we feel like we've gotten to the right place. Because I think that's what happened with the comprehensive revision. It's kind of like drafting a letter. Every time you come back to it, you see more stuff that you want to change. And you don't know when you're going to get to the point where you're happy with it, but you get to a point and all of a sudden you feel a comfort level that you don't expect it to be perfect, but you feel comfortable with it. And that was kind of the experience that I think we had in the comprehensive revision. So, it's hard to lay out a schedule and get there, but if we plug away, we've made the signs a priority, and if we keep them on the agenda basically every meeting and have a small discussion on them, we can kind of find our way through that. Nancy was good enough to email the Sharon and North Canyon sign regulations.
Would there be an opportunity for Nancy to contact those towns and see if they're successful with Prop
30?
Because I like the brevity of Sharon.
Yeah.
Sharon.
Right.
And if it's working, that's nice, because they're such a bitch.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
They're very, very difficult.
It just goes on and on. And so, like you're saying.
Well, right. I talked to the CEO down there this morning.
And Sharon.
Jamie, right. She said they were pretty vague, and they could be problematic from that standpoint. They have historical district regulations, which are more stringent than the Sharon regulations are. And so she figures if they pass the historical district, they'll pass the town regulations.
Except that it's only that historic area.
Mm.
But the historic area is most of the village, and that's where most of the signing issues occur. I think we could take from several different towns and get the best and what works best for us out of looking at different examples.
Well, why are we going away from the last draft that was given to us by Tom McGowan? Why are we reaching out and looking at other regulations?
Well, that's part of what we want to use, I think.
We just haven't gotten that draft yet from Tom. And
right.
I have an idea that came forward on the 25th of September.
I don't know if that's the last one. There were so many of them that I asked Tom for the very, very last one.
Okay, and we have not received it.
Yeah, but in fairness, we only asked him yesterday.
Okay.
After.
Right.
But I would prefer to go back. We spent many hours discussing what Tom had brought forward, and then many, he came back and he came back. Why wouldn't we look at that and continue there, and then if we feel it lacking or it's problematic, search for another solution rather than go out there and bring it all back in and cause ourselves all this trouble? Nancy had said that there was some relationship with the Armenia regulation, mm-hmm. So I called Armenia and I called the retailer that I worked, that I purchased from Armenia. She had no problems with the regulation, but the chap John, who of course knows you, said that they were working fine. They were adopted in 2007. The problem was there was no canopy regulation.
Mm-hmm.
That's the problem that they were having currently. They had a problem with it before, it had been resolved in one situation, but it's back now as a major problem for them. But otherwise, they've been working fine since 2007. So I would be happy to get Tom's new latest draft and go back. I've got all the notes that I wrote on the three other meetings where we discussed it.
Mm-hmm.
And
Yeah, I've got the version before that.
And spend some time and then come back to discuss it as commission.
And look at some of the other towns.
Well, I don't know why we're looking at other towns when we had a plan to look at ours three or four times.
Well, there's a lot too. I think you put too much stock in a planner, okay? We need to look at these regulations from our own town's perspective, and our merchants do have problems with these regulations, and they have had for years. We need to take a fresh look.
Well, that's what we're doing, and that's a fair point.
Well, it's not a fresh look when we're beating the same old dead horse.
No, no, I think what is a fresh look, though, is to get the latest edition, and then we do want feedback from our merchants, and we haven't got to that stage. So maybe before we do anything else, that would be the next thing to do, is get some feedback from them.
What's wrong with looking at these others? I think it's a good idea.
Okay, fine.
I'd like to see a different framework from the last iteration we had. I think that's kind of, just looking at the other ones, that's what I've found. What I've gained from looking
at the other. Okay, so we have a specific objective to set up.
Well, and the framework that's been set up by Tom is very simple, and it's disjointed. It's just disjointed.
Okay, here's what I would suggest is that we look at having a section on purpose, then signs allowed in all zones without a permit, signs allowed in residential zones with a zoning permit. Signs allowed in commercial and industrial zones with a zoning permit.
Right.
Which Falls Village has a pretty good section on. And general requirements. Tom's draft has a pretty good section on general requirements. And then definitions. I didn't see definitions in the Sharon draft.
Yeah.
But maybe they're at the end, in the general definitions for the whole regulation.
Well, that was where we were moving. That's what we were moving toward.
We need to look at how, the things that concern me is how deep are we going to stick our nose into signage? You know, are we going to have sign design regulations? Are we going to go that far? Are we going to ban? Because I know there are opinions to ban certain types of sign. I mean, these decisions all have to be made before you can even begin to write a regulation. You have to know what you're writing a regulation about. And again, like I said at the last meeting, and I'll continue to repeat, the most important opinion on this is the opinion of the merchants in both of these villages. Prior to anything else, including our own opinions, we represent them.
No, that's not exactly true. We represent the town, and it's not just...
Well,
it's representing the people of the town as well, or the interests of the business owners. We're not
the just going
to what our merchants say, or we don't need sign regulations.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Jeremy, do you have
your plan is? I don't know what your plan is for time, but...
Well, the plan is for time is pretty short.
Out before it closes.
Right. I like to know if Justin has...
I don't want to get in here. I only just wanted to quickly reiterate or re-ask that when the commission is considering these regulations, that you consider basically allowing, as the other surrounding towns have, some kind of exemption for signs that are approved by the Board of Selectmen for wayfinding purposes, as an example, maybe even including an up to square footage. And I'd be happy to give you, but I just don't know where it fits because you're kind of, you don't have any, I don't know where it fits into your new regulations, but if you could just, keep that in your, I would love it if you would consider that as part of your considerations for doing the regulations.
That sign you have in Sharon, is that like a freestanding sign? I saw a picture, but is it?
It's on the wall, but between the hair salon and
Rick's on the wall. What? Imagine in the green space between the...
No, it's on the wall. And the nice thing about there is that you can see it when you're driving. When you're driving by, you can see that wall if you're looking for it. But the Sharon Shopping Center is putting up, they're trying to get past the Sharon sign regulations, which in theory the town of Sharon is working on also, to allow them to put up signage for the shopping center that lists the specific businesses in the shopping center, but the shopping center owners also want to have a sign that says visitor information with an arrow so that there is a sign on the street, you know, closer to the road that directs people in there.
Jocelyn, the signs that appeared on Sharon Green, you know, pointing down to it, so that was part of the same spend.
Yeah.
So you did two pole signs, for want of a better word, and then this one.
We did, yeah, three of those white pole signs and that one.
Right. And what was the total cost? It's just a matter of interest.
$9,000.
How much?
$9,000.
It was all covered by the state grant?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, and I would just ask, when you have a wayfinding sign like that that has information about particular businesses, who decides which businesses go in there and how big the print is and all that stuff?
In my experience with the other five towns that I'm working with right now on these, usually I work with a business group like in Cornwall. Cornwall has an economic development commission. Sharon has this business group. And basically, there is a decision that has to be made about what is of interest to a visitor, because we're not putting like plumbers or, you know, landscapers. Mm-hmm. It's where to eat, where to shop, where to stay, where to visit. So there is some, you know, you have to decide whether a hair salon, for example, or is a visitor going to be interested in that. Or,
right.
So there is some judgment that needs to be made, but it's so usually up to the local business group and the town to do that. I mean, in every business group that I work in other towns, the first selectman usually attends all those meetings as mm-hmm. well and is in on all of those.
So if it's a town approved sign, is it ultimately up to the selectman?
Ultimately, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Jocelyn, in terms of our commission soliciting information on what merchants in this town want to see in our new sign regulations, do you have any recommendations of how we can do that, or are you working with a group at the moment?
Well, as you probably know, that what was the Salisbury Economic Development Committee hasn't been meeting. I would think that this is, as you know, you've been to some of those meetings, this is an issue that interests all of them, and we could certainly, you know, there is an email list that we could, if you had some proposed sign regulation, I think you could email it to those folks or call a workshop meeting. I'd be happy to help facilitate if you were interested in that, calling a workshop meeting and saying, we want your input on sign regulations. I think they would appreciate that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, I think we definitely intend to do that. It's just a matter of how to, right?
Well, I think we need to sort of have some place, some idea of where we're going, and then bring the public in.
I think we should discuss that and have our next meeting.
Right, and then have a workshop and bring the, you know, merchants and public in.
On that, I would like to offer a motion to adjourn.
Second?
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.